technology is a glittering lure, but there's the rare occasion when the public can be engaged on a level beyond flash if they have a sentimental bond with the product.
Talking about effective marketing is talking about finely crafted storytelling, and there's few storytelling techniques more powerful than nostalgia. In one of the most iconic moments in television history, Mad Men's Don Draper appeals to that elusive and ever enigmatic concept in order to sell a simple photo projector.
Nostalgia. It's delicate, but potent.
The technology associated with a product is of little importance. What's relevant is how the buyer creates a sentimental narrative to justify buying the product, and ultimately, to see it not only as an inert object, but as a fond memory. However, the most intriguing aspect about this sequence isn't what Don's selling or why, but how he taps into a fundamental truth about human beings. We like fantasy, we like living in it, and we tend spending our time chasing it. The presence of record stores in movies taps into this very necessity, working almost as an emotional crutch that helps cement the bond between the narrative and the viewer. That's why it's everywhere, from dramedies to major Hollywood productions to films featuring loners who spend a lot of time in their own minds. Ultimately, filmmakers use record stores as marketing to a film's emotions, operating as a hub of nostalgia. So today, let's take a look at how the record store enhances emotions, romanticizes moments, blinds truths, and shifts perspectives. Let's dive into the nostalgic power of record stores in movies. Nostalgia is a portmanteau neologism coined in 1688 by Swiss medical student Johannes Hofer, and refers to a sentimental longing or wistful affection for a period in the past. In an article for Psychology Today, Neil Burton refers to the end of Andre Brink's 1975 novel, An Instant in the Wind, in which the central character says, "The land which happened inside us, no one can take away from us again, not even ourselves." Burton goes on to say that nostalgia combines the sadness of loss with a joy or consolation that the loss is not complete, nor ever can be. Mortal though we are, whatever little life we have snared from the legions of death is forever ours. This is an overly intellectual way of saying that nostalgia is the closest thing we have to time travel. It allows us to transport not only the mind, but also the feeling across decades, even centuries. And what are movies if not indelible portals to travels across time and space? Films often recur to record stores, in essence portals of another time and another place themselves, to draw sentimentality and establish a deeper bond with the viewer. Let's begin with movies in which record stores are inextricable from the story itself. There are two cult films very different from each other that revolve around two different stores. We're talking, of course, about Empire Records and High Fidelity. Empire Records has the highly appealing all-in-one-day narrative structure that has worked for other teen-centric films such as Dazed and Confused and Superbad. The spin here is of a subcultural nature. The story revolves around the teenaged employees of Empire Records, an indie music store that's about to be sold to a soulless chain called Music Town. The film came and went when released, and despite achieving something of a cult status, it still falls short for many people, and music lovers in particular. Jesse Hassinger of the AV Club is one of them. He wrote that the movie doesn't just fail to capture hipster bona fides, it seems remarkably neutral about the very idea of pop music. The opposite seems to be true for the beloved High Fidelity, perhaps for being everything that Empire Records is not. The scenes that take place at Championship Vinyl revolve almost exclusively around music and the love for it, even if often through a toxic masculine lens. There's a music snob appealing to the masses to establish superiority.
Sell 5 copies of the 3 EPs by the Beta Band.
The ironic and predatory shaming perpetuated by Kathleen Turner overdrives Barry.
You don't have it? That is perverse. Don't tell anybody. You don't own fucking Blonde on Blonde. It's gonna be okay.
And of course, the revelation of the ultimate truth about pop culture obsessives.
What really matters is what you like, not what you are like.
These moments, as entertaining and reprehensible as they may be, resonate with music lovers because they're handled with the intensity of fiery passion for an art form. They also resonate with non-music snobs for the exact same reason. People love people being passionate about things, Watching it now, an era of distance and lack of physicality, it's not difficult to understand the appeal.
Hang on. Start together.
A third, much more earnest iteration of this type of film is Brett Haley's low-budget crowd-pleaser Hearts Beat Loud, starring Nick Offerman and a terrific Kersey Clemons. In it, a Brooklynite single dad whose record store is on the fast track to bankruptcy deals with his only daughter going to college across the country by turning their jam sessions into a fully-fledged band. Offerman is of course at a crossroads in his life and desperate to stay connected with Clemons. When their song, the titular Hearts Beat Loud, makes it to the Spotify Indie Mix of the Week, they have to deal with their newfound success and the possibility of saving Offerman's business. Here, the record store functions as the core of the dad-daughter relationship, as well as the background to their ever-changing lives, not only as a staple of the present, but as a forecast of what their future might bring. Offerman is both nostalgic for the time he's losing with his daughter, read his own loss, youth, and the store itself, even though he's yet to lose it. In other words, he surrounds himself with nostalgia to live anywhere but the present. Just because certain films take place almost exclusively at a record store, it doesn't mean its power is diminished if used sparingly. Richard Linklater's masterpiece of indie cinema Before Sunrise is a prime example. While roaming the gorgeously historical Vienna, Jesse and Celine wander into an old record store and start browsing. Celine points out that the quaint space even has a listening booth, and Jesse suggests they try it out. What follows is undoubtedly one of the most beautiful scenes ever captured on film. As Kathy Bloom's Come Here plays, Jesse and Celine stare lovingly at each other, falling in love with every new beat, yet too afraid to get caught at their most vulnerable. The scene ends, but Linklater uses the moment created at the record store to first transition into a montage of Jesse and Celine exploring Vienna, and then to emotionally carry the rest of the film. We knew these two young adults were infatuated with each other, but the moment at the listening booth gave birth to a deeper bond, not only between Jesse and Celine, but between the viewer and the film. In fact, if you make it through the whole trilogy and find yourself watching Before Midnight, in particular one of the sequences of Jesse and Celine fighting, you might very well get nostalgic over the moments of love and increased connection described earlier, making Before Sunrise and the Kathy Bloom scene in particular a nostalgic moment within this own meta world. "500 Days of Summer", a film that binds a pair of doomed lovebirds together, tackles fantasy and romantic projection head-on. Tom and Summer take a trip to a record store during which Summer declares her love for Ringo Starr. The film amps up the romanticism of the moment despite Tom wearing an NXS shirt that reads "Love Will Tear Us Apart", a telling sign of their inner states of mind. A later flashback confirms this, suggesting Summer didn't enjoy the trip at all. This is important because the film plays from Tom's perspective, and in the aforementioned scene, he's putting his nostalgia goggles on, allowing himself to be dictated by what the record store is meant to represent, as opposed to what it actually is. The dissonance between the two is a perfect metaphor for what movies so often try to capture, a romantic ideal that projects almost every human's desire to live in fantasy, even if for a fleeting moment. Edgar Wright's Scott Pilgrim vs. the World has the exact same dynamic, but plays it from the perspective of the supporting character. In a gorgeously rendered sequence complete with stylish visual effects, Knives Chow declares her love for Scott Pilgrim, and the titular character not only rejects her, but goes as far as suggesting breaking up.
"We should break up. Or whatever."
It's a deeply cruel and infantile moment, and Edgar Wright capitalizes on it by ditching the record store background and smartly putting Scott and Knives against total blackness. The fantasy is over and they might as well face it. In a brilliant visual transition, Wright cuts to a sequence in which Scott allows himself to linger in self-pity for the decision he just made, only to turn to hurt, only to turn to romantic projection yet again by visualizing Ramona Flowers, the person he thinks is his soulmate. The film succeeds in dissecting wounded masculinity and how it so often turns to hurt to save its own ego. The record store provides the cushion, but also reiterates an idea that emerges in almost every setting. Fantasy is bound to be broken up by the unyielding power of reality. The criminally underrated and underseen Good Vibrations perpetuates that very same thought. Real-life Belfast resident Terry Hooley opens a record store at the height of the Troubles, but soon discovers punk rock and its ability to bind a struggling community together. His success leads him to promote punk bands like the Undertones and the Teenage Kicks on his own label, ultimately leading to the blessing of John Peel and Joe Strummer. Ultimately though, Terry Hooley's product of love appeals to what every vinyl head knows. A record store is a place of comfort that brings people who love all kinds of music together. Of course, reality always has the last word, as we've seen in the past, and in this case, Hooley's forced to reckon with his own personal life and financial downfall.
Is any good?
White.
Seeing the enduring power of record stores in movies allows us to speak to the evolution of human behavior over time, one rooted in the idea of integration. We love new technology and we tend to take things for granted, so generally speaking, when we find something new, we ditch the old, only to start fantasizing about what we lost. This happens all the time. Relationships, fashion, art, you name it. Music itself has been through these cycles before. At one point, the iPod and iTunes practically killed the desire to consume CDs, vinyl, and cassettes. Yet over time, the trend was reversed. This doesn't mean it's either or, just that as time goes by, an equilibrium tends to be reached. This seems to be inevitable every time digital technology and physical media clash. In the end, this idea allows us to frame the power of record stores and movies. Tactility is king. And even though a purely visual medium, a store full of physical media not only cranks up the wheel of nostalgia, but allows a film to feel textured, lived in, and offering a world full of possibilities.